You're listening to the HC Biz Show, the podcast dedicated to unraveling the business of healthcare, and I'm your host, Don Lee. So the pandemic has had a big impact on, well, everything. And in particular, in healthcare, we're looking at states canceling elective procedures. That has had obviously a huge impact on revenue for hospitals, medical practices, et cetera, across the board. Otherwise, you have people that are just scared to go to the doctor and they're avoiding care for that reason. And all of this, you know, adds up to big problems on the revenue side for these health systems and practices. On the flip side, many health plans who would normally be paying those bills are kind of sitting on a mountain of premiums that aren't being spent to cover these services because of deferred care, et cetera. And that could possibly lead to rebates and other kind of negative things for those health plans. And regardless, it leads to a ton of uncertainty of what they're looking at going forward. One of the less obvious outcomes of all this may fall on Medicare Advantage plans, and it's a bit of a doozy. So Medicare Advantage, of course, is the rapidly growing model that covers about 24 million Americans this year. And according to a recent report from Avalere, these plans may be looking at both a sicker population and reduced payments next year as a result of all of this. So here to help us understand what that all means and to share some advice about how Medicare Advantage plans can weather the storm is Dr. Matt Lambert, practicing ER clinician and the chief medical officer at Curation Health. Matt, welcome back to the show.
Yeah, Don, thank you. It's good to be back.
Absolutely. So the listener, you may remember Matt from an episode we did almost exactly a year ago, January of 2020, he came on with his counterpart, Kyle Swartz. We talked about the headwinds impacting value-based care. And you guys had a different company name back then. Same company, but it was Trust Healthcare back then. And now you're Curation Health. So let's start right there and, you know, just tell us what led to a rebrand and just to let the audience know a little bit about what you guys do and where you're coming from.
Sounds great, Don. Yeah, let's revisit the quaint world of January 2020, right, before all this happened.
Different times.
Yeah. So initially we were Trust Healthcare and we were really formed inside of Trust Healthcare, which is a coding and clinical documentation integrity group out of the Midwest. And we decided that we were going to create some technology to help risk capture with this population. And also that primarily, and again, we're probably going to talk a lot about it here, but that's the primary revenue source for Medicare Advantage plans is risk adjustment coding around that. And so we grew up with Trust and we used a lot of their coders and CDI specialists to help craft our tool. And then the first of the year, we went out on our own. And really at the core of what we do is we curate all this noise of data and all this noise of potential diagnoses for providers and for health plans and for Medicare Advantage plans to help them separate the wheat from the chaff of what's valuable and what's not. What really helps them give a truer picture of the complexity of their patient population, because that's how they're compensated for that. And so we went out on our own as Curation Health and have continued to grow throughout the year despite the pandemic. It's been an interesting ride with our Medicare Advantage provider partners through this. But we've continued to improve our technology and improve our services to help achieve our provider plans perform better.
Awesome. Thank you for that. We'll get into a little bit more detail later in the show about how specifically you help Medicare Advantage plans and others in that space. But for the main topic here today, like I said in the intro, is if people aren't getting as much care, and like we can see claims are down like significantly, especially when you look at the periods from when this all started in March, April, May, June, all that time, significantly down. I haven't seen recent numbers, but I gotta imagine we're dealing with a lot of the same. We can get into that. But to the non-expert listener, someone who is non-expert in how health plan business works, you might look at this and say, okay, if health plans are collecting premiums and payments from the federal government and everything else to run these plans, and they are not having to pay the providers as a result, this would seem like it could be a good thing for them. But that's not how it works, right? So can you just tell us a little bit about why is it bad for health plans? I'd say generally speaking, we'll get into Medicare Advantage specifically, but why is it bad for health plans when they're not having to pay out these claims?
Yeah. Before we get into that, just clinically, again, I'm a clinician at heart and like to frame everything through that. In the spring, we didn't know what we didn't know. And we canceled cases again, and that's a huge loss of revenue driver for a health system. We canceled a lot of ambulatory visits, which is probably the second greatest driver for revenue. And a lot of patients were staying away. So we had less coronavirus, but more drastic change in the patient volumes. Fast forward to the end of the year, when we're seeing more coronavirus now than we ever were before, and across the country, not the isolated pockets, patients, we're starting to see some elective cases get cut back a little bit. It's still not the sweeping mandates we had in the spring. It's more health system or county at this point right now. And then the patients aren't staying away either they've kind of overcome their anxiety around this, or they just need put off some of the care as long as they have.
Right.
So from a practicing clinician standpoint, it's challenging more than it was at any other point through this. And I just think that says a whole lot about humans and how we respond to pandemics and sort of thing.
Right.
So if you look at decreased volume in a fee-for-service world, that makes total sense, right? That math is pretty straightforward. If I'm doing less cases, having less visits, we're going to have less revenue. And there was some support for that, came out from the feds, the CARES Act and some other things where they were given some compensation for that. And you know, you can criticize Washington, as I sit here in Washington, you can criticize it all you want for some parts of the response, but the deregulation around telehealth and around reimbursement has been really impressive and really ways to help the health systems weather this storm. It's clear that Seema knows what she's doing when it comes to that kind of stuff. But when you think about value-based care, or when you think about Medicare Advantage, it's reimbursed in a completely different way. It's reimbursed on either a per member per month or a per member per year payment structure. And that structure is tied to your risk score or the cumulative number of your chronic conditions that they've created this model to anticipate. The higher the score, the higher cost and utilization that they think that you're going to have. And so health systems are reimbursed on that on a yearly basis based on their previous year's numbers. So when you think of Medicare Advantage plan or a value-based care plan, they've been collecting those premiums now. And what they will see next year is going to be based upon what they paid out this year or what their risk scores were for their patients this year. So there's an anticipated gap, not only in the utilization, you're going to have a lesser picture of how sick your patient is, but they also might even be a little bit more sick because they deferred care. And I had a couple of examples of that, again, just clinically, anecdotally, my individual practice of that hernia, that if that was repaired in a timely fashion, it wouldn't have become an emergency surgery. I had a couple of examples of that. And one guy in his 50s who was putting off some of his chemotherapy care and he had some complications with his lung cancer where he actually bled into the artery in his lung. And you know, wasn't much to do for that gentleman other than some oxygen and morphine. And so, but he purposely stayed away because of fear of coronavirus. So fee-for-service world, you feel the impact immediately. It's a little easier to support that. Medicare Advantage or value-based care, just because of the reimbursement structure, it creates problems upstream or in the future.
Gotcha. So you mentioned earlier that, you know, the CMS is making some adjustments on that fee-for-service side to account for all of this. Are they, like, if this is a known issue, if they're looking out and they're saying, okay, next year's risk adjustments are probably going to be lower. And if you look at the stats and the claims, there's like people that had diagnoses last year, you're not seeing them in the claims yet this year. So it can be expected. Are they doing anything about it, or are they just going to let this ride out and see what happens?
Currently, they're just riding it out. Do not underestimate the power of the Medicare Advantage lobby and influence on this town, particularly on this current administration. When it switches over to the Biden administration, we're not so sure. But I think that they have a lot of influence here in town. They were able to influence initially when we all went to telehealth visits around March and April. Initially, the rule set was that an interactive video visit, a telehealth visit, not a telephone visit, but a telehealth visit, could not count for a face-to-face visit that is required for a value-based care program. And that quickly changed, I think, in early April, that the Medicare Advantage group was allowed to do that, or anyone in value-based care was allowed to have that type of visit over a interactive audio-visual platform. And they even waived the HIPAA requirement for that. So we watched a really remarkable pivot with a lot of our provider partners doing in-person visits to telephone visits, then to Zoom visits or Google's Hangout or FaceTime visits. And still,
right,
as of where we are right now, you can call, you know, if a senior in a Medicare Advantage plan can FaceTime their grandkids, they can also FaceTime their provider, and the provider gets a value-based credit appointment associated with that. That contributes to those risk scores. So that was the pivot then. I don't know what's going to happen next year around this. I wouldn't be surprised if they don't get some relief. I wouldn't be surprised to see further relaxation of the rules. If you're thinking ahead or saving up for a rainy day, they probably don't need to do that, I don't think. At its best, Medicare Advantage provides private or commercial grade Medicare with extra benefits to seniors. It does. The way it pays for that is it costs more. It costs for me and you, Don, to care for a Medicare Advantage patient than it does a fee-for-service Medicare patient. So that money comes from somewhere, right? There's no such thing as a free lunch. And so one of the Medicare Advantage plans have become a pretty good vehicle for shifting public money into shareholder hands. And that's just the bottom line. And so I would encourage those who are managing the Humana plans and the big plans to maybe just save some of that money instead of paying it all out to shareholders this year, because chances are you're probably going to need it next year.
Right.
So that would be the, if you're really going to lean on the businesses and say, hey, you know, go ahead and had a big year this year, let's plan for next. But I also wouldn't be surprised if they're able to get some relief just because of the relationships they've developed here in town.
Right, right on. So when you say, so let's just talk about this business model a little bit more on the Medicare Advantage side. So if it costs a little bit more to provide better care in the near term, right? Like we're talking about right now today, it's going to cost us more for a Medicare Advantage patient than a Medicare fee-for-service patient. Is the logic that in the long run, there's going to be savings as a result of that better care?
Yeah. And I'm going to go back to the beginning, so to speak, as it would. Go back to 2004, when the commercial insurers, you know, they want to grow, right? They're private companies and they want to grow. And they decided that they were going to grow into the senior care space, which had traditionally been Medicare and services provided by the government. But they knew they couldn't do it at the same costs and would admit that up front. And so the process that came about to help account for that cost was the HCC risk model. And this is a different level of medical coding that's evolved since 2004 to 2020. It's now on version 24 that helps predict the cost for this. And based on those risk models, it's an additive reimbursement model to the private insurers. So they're able to operate at margins that they're used to operating on, and they're able to offer extra benefits to seniors. And again, in a way that comes creates more expense on the taxpayer. Now, obviously, if you're providing services, additional services. And the other thing that value-based care tries to do, either in MA or ACO or anything, by paying in a lump sum for care based upon future, you know, future care based on previous performance, is it's trying to incentivize really thoughtful care and care management. So can we communicate better with our patients? Can we be more judicious in some of the tests that we're running? Can these tests that we're running, can they be tied to proven quality measures or proven activities that have shown to improve outcomes and decrease costs over time? So it's an incentive model that asks providers to focus on value. It's so cliche, but value as opposed to volume.
Right. So, but again, like the long-term expectation is that the taxpayer will pay less over the life of that member, that patient, than they would in a fee-for-service one. So that's what justifies the additional spend now.
Correct.
Is that fair? Okay. So that...
And I think it's pretty, sorry to interrupt,
no,
I think it's pretty enjoyable. It's a good experience for seniors who are entering Medicare. They're receiving healthcare benefits or healthcare services from their payer in a way consistent with what they did when they were in the commercial years. So,
and there's value there, right? Totally, like providing a better life experience for our seniors, I think is worth a few extra bucks too as a society. So like just that in and of itself, I could see some justification for. So now when you talk about how this has become a good way to move dollars to the shareholders, that's because they're operating at these same margins, but now on a larger spend because it's more expensive. So is this, does medical loss ratio and everything work similar in Medicare Advantage to a commercial plan, if you will?
It does, but I think over the years working in the space and helping really bridge the gap between payer and provider in the Medicare Advantage space, you see those additional resources are very much skewed to the payer and not to the provider organization. So I think if there was, as a practicing clinician and someone who spent a lot of time in their career on the health system side, we've got extra resources and we are counting on those extra resources are going to improve outcomes and improve lifestyle. But the payer keeps the lion's share of whatever that additional gain was. And I think as the Medicare Advantage system grows, it's about half of all Medicare enrollees now are in a privatized Medicare Advantage plan. As that continues to grow, and particularly with a Democratic administration who said they're trying to reel this in anyway, I think one of the things they might do is more gain sharing with provider organizations as opposed to shareholders. That makes sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Share with the hospitals, not necessarily as much with the investors.
Yeah, no, that makes total sense. I mean, you guys are the ones physically doing the additional work that we're talking about here, right? So it would make sense that value would be compensated. So like, what's the, like mechanically, how does that work out right now? How does that money stay with the plan, and why aren't health systems and providers able in general just able to negotiate better rates, I guess, knowing that that's the case?
Yeah. Health systems are still primarily operating on a fee-for-service model because of it's the way a hospital revenue cycle is constructed. Heads and beds is what they call it, right? You know, we're requiring a certain amount of revenue to be expected over a month based on cases and admissions and ambulatory visits, as opposed to you've got to be at a point in an organization where you can think 18 months ahead or weather an 18-month storm. I mean, you've got to, it's a pretty big leap of faith to go all the way to value-based care. So health systems are still kind of operating in that old model and are slow to adopt, even though the payers are moving that way.
Okay.
And so it's just a big leap of faith for them that they're not necessarily to make. And then the other thing is, it's been interesting to watch the provider side is getting better at understanding the model. They are getting better at negotiating the model. It's just taken a while, right? Like things do with it.
Okay. So it's a bit of an asymmetry of information and understanding what's going on is what it sounds like, right? Like the health plans are able to maneuver because they understand what's happening a little bit better and how the money's flowing. And the health system side just hasn't quite caught up yet.
Yeah, which is probably the most true statement I can make about healthcare in this country. Payers move faster than the providers.
Got it.
And I think if there's one general rule, that's a good one.
Yeah. Any idea why that is or any suspicion as to why that is?
Just mindset, you know, business acumen versus clinical acumen.
Yeah.
Right. Maybe that 11 years of training, I should have had a business class somewhere along the way.
Fair enough. The first principles are slightly different, I guess, in that regard, right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
All right. So back to this idea then that was, we're looking ahead. You got a Medicare Advantage plan. They are looking at, as you described, potentially a sicker population, and they're looking at reduced revenue. And this report that we referenced at the beginning was estimating that anywhere between like a 4% and 6% hit overall next year. And they based that on kind of three different outlooks as to what might happen with COVID, basically. Was it going to be, you know, we're going to see less COVID, the same COVID, or more COVID? And now we are clearly seeing more COVID. You know, you said it's not playing out quite exactly the same. So how do you feel about that 4% to 6% estimate based on what's going on right now out there in the field?
Well, I mean, it's getting more and more challenging. You know, the health systems are used to maybe getting backed up with a viral disease, i.e. the flu, for a week, especially if the flu hits around Christmas, and between Christmas and New Year's, things are really gummed up for a week. We're going to be gummed up for 4 months with a virus that is three times as lethal as the flu. And it's also been, it's to the point now where not only are hospitals getting stuck, but their historic transfer patterns are getting stuck too. So you're having to keep these patients where they are. You can't transfer them to maybe a higher level of care around that. So there's more COVID than there's been up until now. So I would tend to go towards the higher number. And so having said that, and we'll see what happens with patient volumes just out of their own anxiety. We'll see where that goes.
Right.
We're still certainly going to see more COVID. And we're seeing, you know, again, we're not going to see, I don't think we're going to see as aggressive cancellation of elective cases. I think we're going to be a little bit more, I was getting ready to say surgical about that, but I guess I'll just stick with that pun. I think we're going to be a little bit more precise on what we cancel and where and all those sort of things. All the more reason to embrace telehealth, right? The rules are still, the playing field is wide open. And so for this Q1 of 2021, whatever telehealth patterns you've set up with these patients, you keep going, right? For sure. And double down on it. And it's a pretty common strategy in a value-based care world or a Medicare Advantage world to have that annual wellness visit that's incentivized by Medicare, or to have a comprehensive 60 to 90 minute visit to really set the plan for the year, to make sure that, you know, if you're due for a certain screening test or make sure you got your flu shot or, you know, all those health maintenance things that go a long way. But also what Medicare Advantage providers have been wrapping into that is to make sure they can capture all of those chronic conditions, to make sure they can have a face-to-face visit where we can address your diabetes, we can address your COPD, we can address your hypertension. And not only is that good care and good planning for the year, but that also allows these plans to set their risk score level to capture that in the first half of the year as much as they can.
Right, right on.
So when Avalier's talking about fewer claims, first part of the year, capture as many of those chronic condition claims as you can.
Right.
Early in the year. And that's a pretty tried and true strategy anyway, to do it in person. But I think we're going to see a lot of that focus on that, and we're going to see a lot of that done via telehealth in the first couple of months of 2021.
Yeah. And I was going to say, like, that seems like what you'd want to do anyways. You want to, as accurately as possible, capture and document what is your patient's situation. And I think we talked about a little bit on the headwinds episode that we did last year, but like, why does that happen? Why is it not captured in the first place? And, you know, why do we have to put so much effort into not missing things?
Yeah, it's still 16 years of concept, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's still relatively new. It's not how providers were trained to document. And it's not how most electronic health records were configured to produce that, right? Providers are trained in an E&M or evaluation and management world, i.e. a fee-for-service world. And your electronic health records are aligned and constructed to put that out. So there's really, we're having to relearn how to document certain things, and we're having to relearn how we deploy certain technology to do it. So it's just been, again, it's just that same trend of payers moving quicker than the providers adapting to it.
Gotcha.
And providers might not be incentivized to do something different, right? You know, doctors are people too, and they tend to not do anything, go about their work differently unless there's an immediate incentive for that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. And so as you see certain groups that go full at risk or full Medicare Advantage, they bring on providers with the expectation of, hey, you're going to work this way. You're going to have that 90-minute comprehensive visit early in the year. And we're going to ask you to capture these codes that really help. That's the currency. That's the currency of value-based care. These are the codes that say, that contribute to how sick your patient is, how complex of a patient you're managing, and what we can expect out of their spend. And the interesting thing about it is there's 55,000 codes that don't map to the risk model, and there are 10,000 that do. So in the vein of, it's just not a really good practice to ask clinicians to be data managers.
Right.
So we try and simplify that process as much as we can.
Yeah, right on. Now, so when you say that, when you say, okay, you're heading into Q1 2021, make sure you're really focusing on this. We're talking about Medicare Advantage plans taking this hit. So this is advice for Medicare Advantage plans to make sure they're doing this, which means they're going to just be putting pressure on the physicians to be doing it, right? So walk me through that. And how does that play out? Like, is this just going to be more oversight? Are they going to be making more phone calls, more follow-ups? Like, how is this interaction going to happen between the plan and the clinician?
Yeah, I think, great question. I think really well-integrated groups or groups that have truly embraced this model, they're already there. Right. Their operators have saying, you know, we're going to focus on telehealth. We're going to do it this way. We're going to make sure our telehealth platform is well integrated with the electronic health record. They've done a lot of that. And a lot of folks spent that interim period during the summer when cases were less severe and we all kind of embraced a normal life for a while.
Yep.
I think the smart folks spent that time really solidifying these processes to do this. So that's with the groups that are really well integrated with the either payer owned or well aligned with the payer. Those will adapt quicker to where there's a gap between that, right? If it's a Medicare Advantage plan and you don't have a lot of influence on the physicians on how they do their daily work, then I think you could probably see them maybe even perform a little worse than having that 6%.
Okay.
6%. Yeah. Just like everything with this pandemic, it's created any stress point has been, you know, exaggerated, right?
Right on.
Through all this. One of the things about that Avalere, and I'm going to switch a little bit from quantity to quality. One of the things that was interesting about that Avalere piece is they expect to see because of the volume of claims is why they expect to see reimbursement. In our experience in helping health systems and provider organizations manage healthcare data and HCC coding is it's not necessarily a volume play. It's a precision play. It's interesting that I've been really privileged to get a look at several different populations through this line of work. And we focus on, there's an old saying in medicine, the common things are common, right? And again, it's your hypertension, it's your diabetes, it's your high cholesterol, your CHF, your AFib, your COPD. There's about, from population to population, there are about 12 different clinical conditions that really drive most of their cost and utilization. So I don't think I'm not necessarily worried about volume or fewer claims, but I think all claims aren't the same. All conditions aren't the same, not only in caring for patients, but in how they're risk scored. So I think really focusing on the conditions that are going to really drive your cost and utilization make a lot of sense. If you have fewer visits for the sniffles, right? If you have fewer claims for an upper respiratory infection, that doesn't bother me at all.
Right.
If you're not addressing someone's poorly controlled diabetes, not only are you going to have a less than desirable clinical outcome for that, but you're going to have a less than desirable financial outcome if you're not capturing that. So I would focus more on the specificity of some of these conditions and the conditions that literally have more value than I would the volume. I'm less worried about the volume than I am the makeup of the claims that these patients are seeing.
Yeah, that makes sense. So if you're looking out across your workload, your patient panel and all types of folks, there's going to be some conditions that are just less impactful because there's fewer of them or they're less complicated in terms of the code that needs to be done. And there's going to be some that are more. And what you're suggesting is that when you are looking out as a plan and as a clinician working with that plan, you're suggesting the onus should be put on those more complicated ones, meaning like from a training standpoint or like a just you're focusing on them and talking about them and reporting on them so then people are going to pay attention more? Like, how do you actually play that out in execution?
Yeah, focus on how you manage these patients, right? That's what you're doing. The HCC model, the reimbursement model that's causing the concern about the future, it's based, again, it's predictive on what's going to create outcome challenges and financial challenges for you and the patient moving forward. So by focusing on those key dozen or so conditions, you're focusing on the most important clinical conditions. And again, getting away more from the volume of codes and focusing on the valuable things.
Got it.
And that's it's a good business rule. It's a good clinical rule in general. And it applies well here.
Yeah, right on. Yeah. So in the long run, you want to do all of them better, but just be smart about where you're applying your time and your efforts right now. So that does make sense. So let's play this out again from the business standpoint. If we do see a plan that falls in that, you know, right at that 6% mark or anywhere, really, if there's going to be this gap and that, like anything, has to come from somewhere, right? So what's going to actually happen if a health plan, Medicare Advantage plan next year has 6% lower revenue as a result of this? Who's impacted by that? Like, does that come out of the patient's pockets somehow? Does that come out of the provider's pockets? Is that just going to come out of the shareholders' pockets? Because you already said there was a spread there. Like, how does this play out?
I would encourage my colleagues who are managing Medicare Advantage plans to save for a rainy day, right? This is literally a 1 in 100 year, right? We'll be talking about this year for the rest of our lives. I think we could probably weather one of these with some conservative financial planning and setting expectations with our shareholders, right?
Yeah.
I think you could probably do that. If you're not going to do that, then I wouldn't be surprised to see some sort of relief. Again, there's a Medicare Advantage is a big business in this town, has a lot of influence. So I wouldn't be surprised if there was some relief. I don't think this would reflect direct, just because of how Medicare Advantage plan sits itself in between literally the patient and CMS. I think if there's going to be an exchange or a loss coming out of somewhere, it's going to come either out of the more expenses paid in by the taxpayers or less share given to the health systems before they'll pass it on to individuals.
Right. Gotcha.
I think, but again, I would encourage us to kind of adopt and we're all in this together sort of attitude for another 6 months, right? I think we can do that, can't we?
That sounds fair. So this like kind of dumb question that I probably should have addressed early on is like the overall money flow of Medicare Advantage here. So there is some premium to the patients typically, right?
I'm not going to say typically. You know, you see, well, the enrollment period for Medicare Advantage just finally ended. And I say finally because a lot of us have been at home with our TVs on a lot for the last several months.
Okay.
And from mid-October to December 7th, those Medicare commercials that you've seen over and over again are really, those are Medicare Advantage plans, you know, asking you for a Medicare assessment. But what they're trying to do is get you to sign up for a commercial version of Medicare. They're trying to get you for Medicare Advantage.
Yep.
And so, and the way they incentivize patients to join that plan is offer, sometimes there's no deductibles, some places there are.
Okay.
But extra benefits around that. And it's interesting, it's also literally by zip code, there is modifications based upon the expected outcomes and costs associated with a zip code. So,
right.
So probably the best predictor of whether or not you're going to have to pay a little bit of a copay is where you live and what that expected cost of living adjustment is going to be.
Got it. Those do tend to be considerably lower than everybody else that's in a commercial plan, obviously, because that's the whole point of Medicare, right? Is that the government's picking up the tab, the taxpayers are ultimately picking up the tab. So the money flows from taxpayer to government, and then government pays the health plan based on all of this. Where do the premium dollars go? Do they go right to the health plan or premium dollars to any of that? Does that go straight to the health plan or to CMS?
To the health plan.
Okay. So yeah, I'm just mechanically trying to walk through it in my head. And like I said, that would have been a better setup question than 3/4 of the way through, but here we are. So
yeah, I have the, and just a digression / book plug. I wrote a book called Unrest Insured when I was...
I saw that. I'm glad you brought that up because I forgot to write that down. Yep.
Yeah, and in it, I borrowed a... you know how Vonnegut used to put those silly little scribbles in the middle of his book so that didn't make any sense? You know, you'd be reading the story and then there'd be some drawing that he would draw in there of a parakeet or something.
Okay.
And so I decided to steal some Vonnegutian visuals in my book and kind of just draw a very cartoonish money flow of how it goes from fee-for-service and Medicare and how it goes to fee-for-service Medicare Advantage. So you can draw it out pretty simply, but they're well positioned in the transaction, I think that is the best way to say.
Gotcha. Okay, very good. So we're looking at this like kind of one last question I have around the so what here, like what to expect is One, you said that we might be looking at sicker patients because of the fact that they are deferring care. You know, things progress. That's not what we want, but we're going to be dealing with some of that. But on the flip side, as a clinician, what do you see in terms of like long haul COVID symptoms, right? This is something that we don't know a ton about yet, but we're definitely seeing that it's happening. And that certainly is not accounted for in any of today's risk models. So what do you think you might expect to see there? And then kind of part two would be, do you think CMS accounts for that at all in any of these risk models as we go forward?
Yeah, that's a great question. So it's funny, we just got the code for COVID SARS-19, just got that code, I'll call it formalized October 1, meaning they put an update of the ICD-10 codes out. So that's a formally part of the U code, they call it, is now formally part of the coding. I don't know what they're going to do with COVID long-term. They didn't go back to the swine flu. Swine flu is not part of the risk model now. Swine flu wasn't a risk part of the model back in 09, I think, in 10, and then pulled down. So I don't know what they're going to do with that. There are other codes, I call them sequela codes or consequence codes, that can apply to these patients that can help you predict how they're going to do and help you predict their spend moving forward. So for instance, coronavirus, that might not make it in the HCC code, but chronic respiratory failure might, right? Or pulmonary edema might, or pulmonary hypertension might. Some of these, the more physiologic descriptions of long-term sequela, and I'm going way down in the weeds here, but I'll give you an example. The code for stroke counts for very little in the current risk model. You know, if you've had a history of stroke, it contributes to your risk score for about a month and then it falls off. The code for paralysis, right? Or the code for weakness in your left upper and lower extremity or hemiplegia actually counts a lot towards the risk model because, you know, those patients are going to, unfortunately, they're going to have more blood clots. They're going to get more pneumonias. They're going to get, because of their limited mobility. So the event itself, i.e. stroke, doesn't really count to the risk model at all. The sequela does. So we might adopt that with COVID moving forward. The actual COVID itself is a transient event, but some of those long-term sequela might count towards the risk model over time. And then one other thing, just deep clinical, the post, you know, having a post-viral syndrome is not all that unusual for certain viral illnesses. I think mono is the most famous, right? Where you see patients have these vague fatigue and viral symptoms that last months. I think that's a little bit different in the case of COVID because it's primary pulmonary.
Okay.
So we'll see some unfortunate few have some long-term sequela, and I think they'll deal with it based on the sequela. But I don't know. And again, the direction of CMS, though, this year has been, in response to this, has been really pretty good. And so I would expect them to think in a pretty open-minded way and a deregulatory way, quite frankly. So.
Nice. Okay. So you've kind of like throughout this discussion, we've talked about like what should Medicare Advantage plans be doing here to address all this. So let's kind of like, let's recap the ones that we talked through so far. I'll just let you go. I won't try to regurgitate, but like, what are like the steps now? If I'm running a Medicare Advantage plan, what should I be doing so that I can get through this next year?
Yeah. You've got, what is today, the 9th? So you've got 3 weeks to get your ducks in a row.
Plenty of time.
Because you know, everything, the calendar, the scoring system, the coding system, all reset. You have to address these conditions yearly. So it flips on 1-1. And the first part of the year, I would be prepared to manage to do as many comprehensive visits, long visits, planning visits almost for the year, right? For the rest of the year, where we could lay out a good plan of care in a remote setting for at least half the year, but also do that over telehealth. So you are capturing not a big volume of codes, but you're really capturing those key codes that are going to predict cost and outcomes and utilization and are going to get you a business model that reflects that. And then you're just going to have to manage some of these. You know, you're going to be expecting this, maybe you missed this mass because we didn't do a breast cancer screening, you know, last April. And you're just going to have to plan for that. And again, I think the best way to do that is to focus on the basics and focus on those valuable capture codes. The volume worries me less than the quality of these.
Right.
And that's what we do when, and I'm going to go into just a little bit about curation, if that's...
Yeah, absolutely.
So again, we said we had providers who weren't trained to code this way and a tool that wasn't set up to code this way. So with we pull patient level information and patient claims information, run it through a rules engine, which is now on, I don't say quite version 24, but we update it each year with whatever the new regs are coming down the pike. And we present that in the electronic health record through the APIs. And the APIs have finally become mature enough to where you can really do this well, because we learned that if you ask providers to go outside of the EMR to do anything, it's just not going to happen.
Oh, yeah. Right on.
Yeah. And that's on us, right? We spent a lot of capital getting providers there, and now we're not going to ask them to leave. But what we do with that plugin is we present the codes to them and the quality gaps to them that are, so we basically do a lot of that cognitive load of what plan is this patient in? What are the priorities? You know, this one might be in an ACO, this one might be an MA plan. We align that patient data with all that information and tell the providers, this is what their quality gaps are. You know, this patient needs a flu shot. This patient needs an annual wellness visit. And this patient has four conditions, diabetes, hypertension, COPD, and CHF that you need to address and haven't been addressed yet this year.
Yep.
And so when you see that patient again in 6 months, it'll update and say, all right, we captured all three of those first three, but we didn't get that CHF. So be sure and capture that now. Be sure and manage that appropriately now. You know, do they need an echo? Do they need any typical type of blood work done? And let's capture it there. So we update them and remind them throughout the year of what are those priority codes for that particular patient.
Okay.
Based on the risk model, based on clinical guidelines from the National Quality Forum and from other places.
Right. So if you're saying you've missed the CHF, how are you getting there? Are you seeing lab values that indicate that there is something going on that's not diagnosed, or
yeah,
you know, what's, how do you identify it?
Well, that's through an echo report, through a lab value, could be from a claim from that came from outside that organization, right? It came from somewhere else.
Okay.
But that's the other thing that's pretty interesting about this. A lot of times it can be data mined or we find something, but it's all, it might be something that they're already managing, right? They're probably already managing this patient's congestive heart failure. They're probably on the right medications, but because they haven't documented it a certain way,
right,
it doesn't look like this patient has that to the payers. So, and that's really frustrating for a provider to be like, I'm doing the work anyway.
Yep.
Why didn't I get credit for it? And it's because you clicked I-50.9 instead of I-50.3.
Right. Yeah. They missed the minutia basically that doesn't impact the care. It impacts the reimbursement for the care.
Yeah. And that's where a lot of this frustration is. And that's quite frankly, an easy way to leverage technology.
Yeah.
Right. So that's what technology is for, right? For simple tasks like that. Like
right on.
Anytime we see an I-50.9, we just say, hey, don't you mean I-50.3? Provider goes, yeah, boom. And now you're doing the same clinical care, but you're actually getting credit for it in this reimbursement model.
Yeah, right on. I mean, that's what tech's for. That's how it should be applied, is to sit there quietly out of the way and help me do my job better. And when I don't need it, it's not stopping me. And when it pops up, it's telling me something useful and not distracting me with garbage. So like that's the just well-applied technology, no matter what the use case is, that should be what you're going for.
To whether it's clinical coding and HCC coding, or whether or not it's operating the Zoom meeting that we had earlier today, right?
Yeah,
sure,
right.
We're not going to share. We won't share that any challenges we had early on with this, yeah, with the listening audience, right?
No, these always go perfectly. There's never any technical difficulties with podcasts. So that's why they always sound so good when it's done. But
that's right.
So one other thing on that is these diagnosis codes, like they expire over time too, right? In a sense, isn't it something like after, like if you capture it and it's in a record and it counts for 2 years or something like that, and then you have to kind of put it back in. So you might be caring for a patient over time, and then you did diagnose them, and now it's kind of slipped away. Is that another thing, or am I making that up?
No. It's so, again, there are 65,000 diagnosis codes, right? ICD-10 codes. And those map to 86 HCC codes, right? So there's another good use for technology, right? One-to-many mapping, right? It's like we can do that, and we can update it each year. Some of those codes, even you have to address them each year. You have to address that diabetes every year in order for it to contribute to the risk model. I think the best example of this is an amputation. Let's say you're unfortunate enough to have had a below-the-knee amputation because of your chronic diabetes. If you don't document that that patient has an amputation every year on 1-1, then the model just assumes that you grew a leg back.
That's real dumb.
Yeah. Right. And that's the example I usually use when providers say, why do we have to do this each year? It's like, that's if you want to get credit, right, for managing a patient who's sick enough to have had a limb amputated, then you've got to document that once a year. On the flip side, some things resolve, right? Some things that contribute to the risk model. Cancer is the best example of that, right? At some point, it becomes a history of cancer as opposed to one of the active cancer codes. And that's really an example where we can use the technology to direct a provider to downcode, right? Appropriately, right?
Right. Yeah, you got to do both, right? Absolutely. That's a good point.
Yeah. And so there's sometimes when we actually lower these risk scores, but it's the right thing to do and how you're managing these patients. So it goes with, so some resolve, to your point.
Yep.
Some need to be addressed each year, even if something as simple as having an amputation. So it's a...
Yeah, right on. No, the downcoding is interesting. It's like, I've heard people talk about this, like finding missing DX as like a bad thing. Like, oh, they're just combing through records to try to get more money. It's like, well, no, you need to get the right amount of money to deliver the care. So it's set up that way on purpose. And if you don't take in enough money to do the right thing, there's a good chance you're not going to do the right thing. So it's not about maximizing coding. It's not about maximizing revenue. It's about accurately representing the health of your population, regardless if it's up or down, so that you can build your business around it appropriately and give the proper care to your patients and give a fair shake to the taxpayer, ultimately.
Yeah.
It's, you know, what we all want. So yeah, I'm glad you brought that point up.
Yeah, and there will be some malfeasance, and there has been, and there will be, right? That's just the
sure. The
nature of things. But to if this is the risk model that we're going to be judged on reimbursement or quality outcomes, right? Providers, you know, get a lot of dashboard on how you compare to your peers. If you're more accurately using the codes that they set the rules by, then you're going to perform better there. And I agree. And that's why we talk about the Avalier piece was talking about volumes. Like, I'm less concerned about volume than I am specificity.
Right.
For these sort of things.
All right. So as we think about your platform in particular, right, because you're automating all of this, throughout we have been talking about focusing on the quality of capture and the cleanness that you're doing. And you said, make sure that you're focusing on the ones that are really important. Like when you're coming up with your plans and your strategies and your guidance for your physicians and everything else, like make sure you're capturing the really important ones. Now, that shouldn't be an issue if someone's using a platform like yours where all of this stuff's automated, right? Because you're going to tell me my gaps are for the, quote, less important ones, at least from the context that we're talking about here, just the same as you're going to tell me for the other ones, right? Or is there some kind of, like, does that make its way into your model too somehow?
If we try to align the specificity of the coding up as much as we can with whatever the risk model is. And again, there are a couple different ones. They tend to all branch off of the HCC CMS model version 24, and they all kind of vary off of that. A good example is the N18 code has been retired. That's for kidney disease, right? So we don't expect the providers to keep up with, I'm the only doctor I ask to keep up with whatever the coding updates are from CMS each year, right? And then we create the technology to do that. So if we see an old code, an N18.3 code coming through, we suppress it and we present, hey, this is a new updated code. You want to pick on this one.
Yep.
So I think updating it or directing providers to whatever the latest rules are is really a value that we can do at scale around it.
Right on.
Plus, there are a lot of other CDI, again, clinical documentation integrity specialists who are usually nurses or someone with a clinical background who does this before, like maybe do a pre-visit review for the provider to try and tee things up. There's a great value in presenting them with an updated list, right? Because otherwise, you can spend as much time on a vitamin D deficiency, which doesn't drive a lot of cost and utilization and certainly doesn't get you anywhere to the risk model. You can spend as much time aligning that code and documenting on that code as you do something like, I'll just say a thyroid problem, right? Which does address to the risk model. And so again, just trying to focus, get everyone to be as efficient as they can be and free them up to practice medicine. Just doing all that other cognitive and administrative load. And again, it probably doesn't change their management. They're probably going to do the same thing they were taught to manage this condition.
Right.
But at least they're going to get compensated for it on both the quality measures and the financial measures if you do it a certain way. And interestingly, and I'm just going to slight digression maybe, the reason not only when they came up with this risk scoring piece, not only was it to help Medicare Advantage plans who say, well, yeah, we'll manage these patients, but we can't do it at the cost the federal government can. The flip side of that is they created this to prevent patient selection, right? Because if you're going to do value-based care, what in insurance parlance is called the moral hazard here, right? Is you're going to try and get as many healthy people enrolled into the plan as you can.
Yep.
And deny coverage to the sicker ones, right? Who are going to be more expensive. And so one of the reasons that we have this model is that it's going to prevent that. It's going to say, as long as you are tracking these patients' medical problems, we're going to compensate you accordingly for assuming risk for a sick patient.
Right. Yeah, no, that totally makes sense. And at the risk of opening a whole other line of discussion, because this too is something I've been thinking about, is are we, by following that logic, which makes a lot of sense, are we cutting ourselves short? Because and you have to find a safe way to do this so that there's not this kind of adverse cherry picking, if you will, but if you are able to kind of build systems and build plans that specialize in caring for diabetics with, you know, diabetics who had COVID, who had, you know, this very specific kind of group of patients, and let them be exclusive to that group and let them take care of that group, that could allow the plan and the providers and everybody involved to really focus in on being very good at taking care of that subset of a population and not have to worry about, well, our system makes sense when it's this and it doesn't make sense when it's a pretty healthy 65-year-old that doesn't have chronic conditions, but they come here anyways and everything gets gummed up. Like, do you see any opportunity for that? Again, like I said, risking a whole other storyline here, but do you see any opportunity there where we could specialize in this stuff and say, no, you do take care of just that type of case. Please cherry pick, but we're going to build our model around what you're cherry picking.
Great insight. And either fortunately or unfortunately, they're way ahead of you, pal.
Good.
So, and it's not separate pools, right? Because it's not very, and I'll use the case of chronic kidney disease, right? Chronic kidney disease, you do as much as you can for managing these patients to keep them from going on dialysis. Because once they're on dialysis, clinically, the outcome's not going to be good. And the cost is not going to be good and associated with that. And it's a horrible quality of life. So you take kidney disease patients, but they also have, probably have diabetes. They also have hypertension. That's why they have kidney disease. So these patients very rarely occur in a vacuum. So you don't see it broken up into that measure. But you say, let's say Humana's got a group of 10,000 Medicare Advantage patients, and 2,000 of those already have an existing diagnosis of chronic kidney disease. There are companies now that that's all they do. They have care managers and physicians who help make sure that your kidney disease management is optimized as long as it can to keep you off of dialysis.
Gotcha.
And that becomes a split or share of the per member per month or per member per year payment. So it's same holistic payment structure.
Right.
Driven off of HCC codes done at a year based upon previous expectations, but they divvy up that pie for that patient based upon how well they can manage those certain chronic conditions. So yeah, so we see that a lot in behavioral health, see that a lot in kidney disease, see that in advanced heart failure of these subspecialist groups underneath that. And the cool thing about that is it's really maximizing the, you know, if we get the same outcome from a text message as we can an office visit, then why are we doing an office visit, right?
Right. Yep.
And so if we can text a patient every day and remind them to take their medication at this dose at that time, and that helps them live better longer, then that's a better idea now in 2020, right? Especially that we're all used to conversing remotely. It's a much better model than coming into the office, dropping a 99213, doing all that other kind of stuff. So that's what excites me about value-based care. It's pretty messy getting there, but it's forcing us to re-examine what is really effective, you know? What is really effective? If it coming in, my sister just lit into me the other day about how she had to take a day off work. She had to go, you know, she had to go to her doctor, then she had to go to the lab, then she had to go to the pharmacy. She's like, this could be done in like 30 minutes. Instead, it took a whole day for me to get my thyroid medication.
Yep.
So I think we should just, the farther we can go down that road, the better off we're going to be.
Yep. And I've heard the reverse of that story throughout the pandemic where they were like, normally I would have had to take a day off of work and find childcare and everything else. They're like, it was 15 minutes on my phone and I was done. It was amazing. So yeah, I do hope value-based care continues to drive that. I hope that we're smart about kind of putting things back to normal with a lot of these things that have been relaxed over time. Like, you can't leave everything, I'm sure, that has been relaxed, but let's be smart about how we go back to quote normal. Let's not go all the way back and let's take advantage of some of these things that we've learned. So
agree 100%.
Yeah. So yeah, Dr. Matt Lambert, Curation Health, this has been awesome. Thank you so much for coming again to share with us. I'll link up our past show. I'll link up a whole bunch of information about your company. But for the listener right now on the way out, where can they go to learn more about Curation Health, connect with you online, anything else you want to share?
Yeah, curationhealth.com is the website, and I'm at M. Lambert at Curation Health. So please, by all means, reach out directly if you want to. And also I'm going to go ahead and talk on, you can go to amazon.com, you go to my author page if you want to.
Oh, right on. We'll link that up too.
Yeah, and Unrest Insured. And also actually wrote a book previous to that on healthcare reform called Close to Change.
Very nice.
So it's just a fascinating time to be in healthcare. And I agree with you on let's try and learn from this and make it better. And if any of your listeners think that talking to Curation Health might help them plan for their transition to value-based care, then we would certainly welcome that conversation.
Right on. Well, thank you again for coming. And to you, the listener, thank you as always for letting us learn with you. We'll see you next time on the HC Biz Show.